Yes, ma'am. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome our next speaker, Anvish Haseja sir, CEO Commercial Habibganj Railway Station Redevelopment Project, and Abu Asif sir, team leader Bansal Group Private Limited. Sir, BIM innate itself in its immediate strengths and focused approach towards placements strongly complemented with state of the art IT infrastructure, rigorous training and grooming, a regularly updated syllabi and robust process that are constantly aligned with the new industry requirements. Bearing the testimony to this is the excellent successful campus placement of the students from the batch 2019 to 2021. May I now request student manager Munish Sharma to introduce our guest, Anvish Haseja sir.
Thank you, Prashish. Good morning, everyone. I, Munish Sharma, student manager of Sri Balaji University, deem it a privilege to introduce to you Mr. Anvish Haseja sir. Sir is currently serving as the CEO for Habibganj Railway Station Redevelopment Project. Here, sir is responsible for conceptualization and execution of the redevelopment of the first railway station of the country. Before starting his personal career, sir completed his education from highly prestigious institute, that is Delhi College Business School and St. Joseph College, Nainital. Sir has had an illustrious career spanning of more than 35 years. Sir has over 15 years of experience as a director in Central India Motors Private Limited, where he handled sales strategies for automobiles and dealers, principal relationship with automobile companies. Sir has over 2 years of experience as a director in Narsingh Trading House, where he was responsible for territory enhancement for various districts. Sir has over 11 years of experience in entertainment world developers as a director of business development and executive vice president leasing, where he was responsible for land acquisition, project funding, project conceptualization, and brand relationship. Sir has also worked as chief operating officer for more than 2 years with Zion Hills Homes Private Limited, where he was heading real estate responsibilities, pre and post customer care and leasing. Sir also has substantial experience and extensive knowledge in real estate development, corporate communication, strategic planning, asset management, and new business development. Sir possesses excellent leadership qualities and professional credibility. I feel honored to present this virtual platform to you. I am sure we will learn a lot from you and your experiences. Thank you.
Thank you, Munish. May I now request student manager Prati Tejwani to introduce our guest, Abu Asif sir.
Hi, Prachi Tejwani, student manager of Balaji Institute of Modern Management, Sri Balaji University, Pune. I'm privileged to introduce today's guest speaker, Bansal Pathways Habibganj Private Limited. Sir has 29 years of corporate experience in the field of...
Entire development, redevelopment is planned through PPP mode with no additional burden to the railways. Sounds incredible how a railway station can look like an airport. Well, seeing is believing. I would want to share this video with you, which will help you conceptualize and understand what we are talking about. I request Ramesh sir to please play the video.
Yes, ma'am.
हबीबगंज रेलवे स्टेशन को भारतीय रेलवे IRSDC एवं बंसल ग्रुप के संयुक्त प्रयासों द्वारा पुनर्विकसित किया गया है। मध्य प्रदेश की राजधानी भोपाल में स्थित ये स्टेशन सार्वजनिक निजी भागीदारी मॉडल पर आधारित भारत के पहले वर्ल्ड क्लास रेलवे स्टेशन के रूप में तैयार हुआ है। अन्य रेलवे स्टेशनों से बिल्कुल विपरीत हबीबगंज रेलवे स्टेशन सैलानियों और यात्रियों के लिए एक आदर्श स्थान होगा। हवाई अड्डे की तर्ज पर आधारित इस रेलवे स्टेशन पर ट्रेन से आने वाले व जाने वाले यात्रियों के लिए एक खास सुविधा दी गई है। ट्रेन से उतरने वाले ट्रेन से उतरने के बाद सबवे मार्ग से सीधे निकास क्षेत्र की ओर निकलेंगे और ट्रेन में चढ़ने वाले यात्री ऊपर एयर कॉन्कोर्स मार्ग पर प्रतीक्षा करेंगे और ट्रेन की पूर्णतः साफ सफाई हो जाने के बाद ही ट्रेन में चढ़ेंगे। इस अनूठी पहल से भीड़ भाड़ की स्थिति से निजात मिलेगी। नए भारत निर्माण की तैयारी में हबीबगंज रेलवे स्टेशन एक मुख्य पड़ाव बनकर उभरा है। पैसेंजर्स के लिए आधुनिक सुविधाओं से सुसज्जित इस रेलवे स्टेशन पर नए नए व्यंजनों वाले रेस्टोरेंट्स और कैफेज 24/7 यानी कि 24 घंटे संचालित की जाने वाली हेल्प डेस्क और इंक्वायरी काउंटर, यात्रियों के सफर को आसान करने के लिए टैक्सी बुकिंग और टूर्स एंड ट्रैवल स्टॉल, बड़े ब्रांड्स की गारमेंट शॉप्स और गिफ्ट शॉप्स, स्वास्थ्य के लिए लाभदायक जूस सेंटर्स, इसके अलावा बुक स्टॉल्स, फ्लोरिस्ट शॉप्स, सलॉन्स, एटीएम, मेडिकल शॉप्स, अन्य परचेज स्टोर, लगेज रखने के लिए लॉकर रूम्स और यात्रा के बाद या पहले थकावट दूर करने के लिए आधुनिक रेस्ट रूम्स व डॉर्मेटरीज यहाँ की भव्यता का प्रमाण है। केवल यात्रियों और सैलानियों तक सीमित ना रहकर ये रेलवे स्टेशन शहर के सबसे बड़े सार्वजनिक स्थल के रूप में भी अपनी अलग पहचान बनाएगा, जहां न केवल बिजनेस मीटिंग्स बल्कि मेहमानों का स्वागत, दोस्तों के साथ कॉफी का आनंद, शॉपिंग और मनोरंजन सुविधाओं का आनंद लेने के साथ साथ अन्य आधुनिक शहरी माहौल का अनुभव भी लिया जा सकेगा। ट्रेन का इंतजार कर रहे यात्रियों के लिए लेवल 1 पर विभिन्न कियोस्क और वेटिंग रूम्स की सुविधा दी गई है। वहां मौजूद न्यूज़पेपर, मैगजीन, खान पान व अन्य मनोरंजक सुविधाएं आपके इंतजार को सुगम बनाएंगी। स्टेशन पर अधिक जन समूह इकट्ठा ना हो उसके लिए यात्रियों को अनाउंसमेंट पर ही स्टेशन में प्रवेश दिया जाएगा। सर्व सुविधा युक्त इस रेलवे स्टेशन की 24 घंटे संचालित विशालकाय स्मार्ट पार्किंग विजिटर्स को भीड़ भाड़ व जाम से निजात देगी और उनका समय बर्बाद नहीं होने देगी। लयबद्ध तरीके से निर्मित एंट्री पैसेज और मॉल की तरफ निकलकर निकास क्षेत्र की ओर जाने वाले सबवे मार्ग सुविचारित, संगठित और व्यवस्थित संचालन प्रवाह का एक बेहद सटीक उदाहरण है। वास्तव में हबीबगंज रेलवे स्टेशन भविष्य में निसंदेह सबसे प्रशंसित एवं वैश्विक यात्रा के लिए एक मील का पत्थर साबित होगा। इसके अलावा बंसल ग्रुप द्वारा निर्मित मध्य भारत की सबसे ऊंची व्यावसायिक इमारत बंसल वन, बंसल प्लाजा शॉपिंग मॉल, 5-स्टार होटल और बंसल मल्टी स्पेशलिटी हॉस्पिटल हबीबगंज रेलवे स्टेशन पर यात्रियों को आधुनिक स्थल का अनुभव कराएंगे।
So I'm sure that video has truly left you amazed, and today we have two amazing guests, Mr. Avnish Hasija and Mr. Abu Asif, the two people instrumental in making this dream project a reality. I welcome Mr. Avnish Hasija, the person who conceptualized and strategized the commercial aspects, and Mr. Abu Asif, the chief engineer who converted this concept into brick and mortar reality. I welcome both of you, sir, to Sri Balaji University.
Thank you very much, Dr. Archana. Hello, everyone. Hello, students. It's been some time now that I've been called to address students. It's mostly been attending to press meets or people coming and asking, politicians asking for what the whole station was about, what has been done. It's actually really a pleasure to address the students and taking this forward. Archana ji, I saw that you wrote to me and you said that what is different in this station.
Absolutely, sir. So my first question to you would be, you know, so much of curiosity has been evoked. So we would want you to tell us how this project is different than conventional railway stations.
Well, now that you have seen the video, I put the question to the forum. What did you find so different in the station? Tell you the basic difference in this entire project is the name of the project in itself. Our Honorable PM named this project Changing Perception of Railway Stations, Creating World-Class Railway Stations. So this is the first tiny step towards the creation of this vision, taking the vision forward. Operationally, if you see, the largest difference that lies here is the segregation of the deboarding and the boarding passengers, which has never been the case in any of our railway stations. Whatever we see in our railway stations today is platforms filled with chaos, filled with crowd, people pushing to get in, people pushing to get out. All this has been given a miss. All this has been corrected. You have passengers deboarding first. They take the subway and they exit out of the building. While they are exiting the building, they are floored to see the ticket counters for the buses, for taxis. They'll be seeing flower shops, sweet shops. They can buy stuff, take it back home. At the same time, the passengers that are waiting to board the train are up on the concourse. Now, the concourse is nothing but a terminal that you see in your everyday lives in the airports. Once the train is cleaned, these passengers come down to the platforms and board a clean train and carry on with their journey. So this is the biggest difference that is there. And the entire atmosphere, the experience that a passenger gets is responsible for changing the perception of today's passengers. So in my saying, I think this is the biggest change that you find, and you will find once you travel by train. You have been to malls, you have been to shopping centers, you have been to corporate commercial buildings. Everything will be housed as a part, integrated part of the railway station complex that is being developed. So this is what is the major difference that is there in this railway station. I'm not talking anything about aesthetically how it looks, the cleanliness that is going to be there. You have seen the photographs. You will be seeing how, once you come here, you will be seeing how well the maintenance is being taken place of these stations, because the maintenance as well is in our hands. So this is what will change the way a passenger looks at the railway station today.
Great, sir. So I think, sir, restaurants, malls, spa, multiplex, lounge, party place, in short, all the things associated with leisure, and that too at a railway station. So quite a thought disruption. So we would want to ask you, what prompted you to choose a railway station for coming up with this kind of a commercial project? And what is the economics behind this decision?
Well, if you go to see, the government wanted the development of railway stations to happen. A, the government wanted a world-class station to come up. The government didn't want to spend money. What did the government have? The government basically had the land that is there. Today, I believe railways is the biggest landlords of our country. And if you actually go to see, the stations are right in the midst and the heart of the cities, wherever they are. The land there is very short and potential. They have not monetized or explored the potentiality of the entire land that is there. So what are they doing now? So they are bidding, they are raising bids. Developers who are experienced are basically bidding, seeing the feasibility of the land that is coming through. They are building the railway stations as per the designs and the wants of the government, delivering it and realizing their money and cost out of monetizing the land. Now, how do you monetize land? Land gets monetized by getting revenues from offices, getting revenues from hotels, getting revenues from shopping malls, getting revenue from multiplexes. In our project, there is a first which has never been there. We have also planned a 400-bed multi-speciality hospital because the location was such that this class of real estate was also very, very preferential. And these are the things which give a twin effect or a double effect to the entire project. They act as offerings for the passengers. They add to the amenities that a railway station offers, offers to the passenger who's commuting from the rail, and they bring in revenues for the railway station as well as for the company that has developed these railway stations. So this is a very, very essential part to get in revenues so that the entire project then gets sustainable and profitable in itself to the developer as well as to the government. So I hope this answers your question about the malls, about the restaurants. So it's a very, very techno-commercial decision that has happened. At the same time, we are also fulfilling the experiences that the government wishes us to give to a fellow person.
Sure, sir. So Abu Asif, sir, the person who took this project out of the drawing sheets to ground zero. So Asif, sir, how difficult was it to do all this mammoth construction work, even when the station was operational as usual, with all the trains running and all the passengers there?
It was difficult. Difficult in the sense that there is no such precedence in history wherein any station development or redevelopment has been taken up in an integrated mode.
Asif, sir, you're not very clearly audible, sir.
Is my voice clear now?
Sir, it's feeble, sir. It's.
Hello, can you hear me?
A little better, sir.
Hello.
You come here.
So maybe can I just suggest if you can try without the headphones, maybe that will be better, sir.
Hello.
Yeah, that's much better, sir. Yes.
That's great.
Yeah.
Something wrong. Yeah. Your question was how difficult it was to,
the construction.
drawing tables to the, I mean, the reality. In fact, it was indeed difficult. And difficult in the sense that this is for the first time in the history of Indian Railway that any station has been developed or redeveloped in integrated mode. Integrated mode means, if you see at the development of any stations on Indian Railways, they first make a building, they lay the track, single track, then they make one platform, and as and when the requirement arises, they just add another platform, another footover bridge, and they add another platform, some more buildings. That's how it has happened since independence. But this was the first time that the integration, I mean, the redevelopment has been taken in integrated mode. Integrated mode as in, the central idea of this project is to upgrade the passenger amenities at all the Indian Railway stations. So Habibganj was one of the batch of first five. Though the other four did not take up with Habibganj, and Habibganj stands completed now. The most difficult thing or most challenging thing was, there was no such precedence of any such integrated development of any Indian Railway station. And the developer, we the developer, and me as an engineer, did not have the confidence of railway officers, their construction team, their operational team, their strategic team, that we shall be able to pull up or we shall be able to construct this station. So the biggest challenge was to, I mean, ensure that while working, no passenger should be harmed. There should not be any damage to surrounding property or any damage to or hindrance to the train operations. And just because there was no such precedence, so we were asked to develop rather the construction methodology, the sequencing, and how we shall proceed. And as there was no precedence, so, and being the team leader, it was my responsibility to prepare the documents, methodology, and sequencing, so that all the concerned officers gets convinced and they approve the plan. And the best thing was, we with our team, we made plans every day, and next morning we changed it when we reached the actual working site. So, but still we were able to put, and the biggest thing, and the biggest, I mean, I would say the most remarkable thing was that no accident happened during the concurrency of this entire project. And being this, I mean, I'm addressing a symposium of management, so I'll not go into the engineering details of it, but this concession agreement is also unique. In general, we can call it as a BOT project, wherein you invest the money or developer invests the money and he gets something in barter. But herein, a check was imposed that you can start the construction of your commercial activities or the commercial buildings and the station buildings simultaneously. You can make the commercial bookings also, advance bookings, what you say for the commercial project. But until and unless you commission the railway station, you cannot commission your commercial buildings. So as a team leader, my biggest challenge was to ensure that this station gets commissioned within the time period so as to prevent the losses, the financial losses that may occur due to the delay. And my team has been able to, do such thing. I mean, we have achieved that, and that is all credit goes to my team and your support from the railway officers also. Earlier, they were not very confident of our activities actually, and we were under constant check and vigilance. But as time went through and as we progressed through the construction, the biggest challenge was to create subways through the running lines. There are 12 running lines at Habibganj Yard, and we have to create 2 subways. There are two alignments of the subways. So we had to cross tracks at 24 points, back to running tracks. That was the most challenging thing, and we have achieved it without any failures, accident. Yes, there were certain time runs that has occurred, but then we finished it successfully.
Indeed, Asif sir, very, very commendable in spite of the many challenges that you could achieve this. The next thing we would want to know from you is, footfall is good news, but then managing the very high footfall is also a challenge. So what measures have been taken in the layout and designing of this complex to handle the large number of passengers on one hand and also the visitors or customers on the other? What kind of maybe holding areas, parking facility, and other features that you have designed in the layout of the complex?
Okay, that is, a central question, I would say the principal question of this project. This project was envisaged with a view to upgrade the passenger amenity without any capital investment from the treasury or the railways. So the land parcels was accorded to the developer within the station campus and within a very close proximity of an operational station. So the master plan for the parking is, developed in such a way that the station area users and the commercial area users, the parking must not clash, shall not clash. So for all the commercial buildings, there is a provision of basement parkings. Basement parking and is in all the, there are 4 commercial plots associated with this railway station redevelopment, and every building, every commercial building has got 3 basements, which we have increased the height of roof slabs so as to incorporate stack parking. So I've got 6 floors of parking, basement parkings plus 3 parking at floor 3 and floor 4. So out of 15 floors, we have 9 floors of parking for the commercial activity. So even if there is an increase in number of commercial visitors, there will not be any shortage of parking space. For station users, we have redesigned or retweaked the space available, and we have did laning and in such a way that the drop and go vehicular movement shall not hinder with the parked vehicle. And we have, reformulated the parking charges in line with urban transport policy, so that it, which encourages the use of public transport more and discourages the use of public transport. So, not completely, but yes, we have used that. So there is a segregate parking facility for commercial users and as well as railway users. As far as footfall on, footfall of this railway users, as you might have seen in the video, that there is a theory and application of passenger segregation. All the departing passengers shall use air concourse, and all the arriving passengers shall use subways. So we have tried to segregate the arriving passenger and departing passenger for a longer period of time. Their intermixing shall be only for the duration when the trains arrives and when the passenger deboards and passenger alight the train. So then that shall check a lot of chaos. It will not eliminate the intermixing of passengers altogether, but 90% of the problem is solved that way by this air concourse and subway.
Great. Thank you so much, sir. A lot of thought, a lot of planning has gone into it, and I'm sure it's going to be a wonderful project that we'll all get to see. My next question is to Mr. Avnish. Sir, this entire development, redevelopment is planned through public-private partnership mode. So after this experience, what will you say are the advantages and challenges of a PPP model?
Well, the basic advantage of the PPP model
is that you are resting the planning, the development, execution, and management with corporate houses. Corporate houses, as you know, are in business. And it's their business to be in business. Whereas the government is not really a business-minded organization as such. So once you hand over a property or you hand over a project, any kind of a project, whether it's industrial or recently we have been thinking that Tatas are getting the Air India back with them. And you will soon see the improvement with Air India that comes through. Same the case here in this particular project. The very fact that PPP mode has been followed, the money has to be spent by the corporate house that is undertaking the entire project. As you know, corporate houses are very meticulous in doing their financial planning, their feasibility, and then acting upon what has to be done, what has to be made, how it has to be priced, what all has to be offered, so that the entire project goes right in every manner. And I hope we'll be able to demonstrate this once we deliver the Habibganj project as a whole to everybody. Our local customers, our international customers will see the development of the commercial buildings. The locals, the fellow passengers will see the development of the station and the mall. We'll be having patients coming into the multi-speciality hospital. We'll be having travelers coming into the five-star hotels as well as the budget hotels. So the difference will clearly be shown. We are very, very sure about that. And the fact that we are taking time in planning, we are taking time in seeing what needs to be done, is only because we need to cover the costs and yet make profits on what we have spent and what we have planned. So overall, I think it's a much better exercise to plan projects and to hand over. You'll be surprised, even the Honorable Minister tried two projects in hand. It's yet to be seen. You must have gone through the papers, say around a month and a half back, when the Gandhinagar station was developed by IRSDC. They have made a five-star hotel over the running railway station building. And this was done by IRSDC themselves. Whereas this project of Habibganj, at the same time, had been given to the PPP model so that the railways can also judge what is a better way of development of railway stations, whether directly by RSDC or by the PPP mode. So I think moving forward, there's going to be always a mix of both, where the government is undertaking developing of some stations and PPP mode, where they are handing over the station development to a corporate house or to a businessman. So,
right, sir. So we hope it will be a win-win for all the parties here.
Yes, yes. So let this be, station get delivered. Probably, I'm sure the ministry would be doing comparisons, numbers as to the costs, as to the time taken to build. It's still not a comparison of an apple to an apple, because over here there is a complete set of a new station which has been made, new platform coverings, refurbishing that has been done, commercial building setups that have been made. Whereas in the Gandhinagar project, there is just a five-star hotel that has come up over a running existing building. So, yes, but
sure,
it is to be seen.
Yes, I'm sure it will be a benchmark project going forward.
Yes, it is. It is obviously a benchmark. Whatever is the first is always a benchmark. It will set up. It has to set a mark either in a better way or on the worse. So, and we are sure we'll be setting a positive benchmark and a starting model to show that what a small town like Bhopal can do. So you can very well imagine what the metros will offer. So I think that will be a very, very interesting point going ahead to see that how much better can a metro and how much more can a metro add to a railway station to give a better feel.
Right. So Asif, sir, since this is a railway station and a commercial hub under the same roof, you would not only want passengers, but also customers visiting in large numbers. So have any provisions been made to connect this station to other key points in the city so as to provide a convenient transit conduit?
Yes. I mean, the location of Habibganj railway station is very close to ISBT, that is Interstate Bus Terminus. So there is a proposal of connecting ISBT to railway station on the eastern side. ISBT is on the eastern side through a walk bridge. I mean, foot over walking bridge, approximately 900 meters. But that shall be taken up by smart city development authorities. And there is a metro alignment running parallel to the premises of Habibganj railway station on the western side. So there were interactions with the divisional railway officers, ourselves, and the metro officials. And a proposal has been approved. In Bhopal, this metro railway alignment is an elevated alignment, and there is a mezzanine platform for that metro. The level of that mezzanine platform is almost same as our air concourse level. So we will be connecting our air concourse level to the metro station. So any passenger who wants to use Habibganj railway station or vice versa need not to climb down and climb up every time and cross the street. They can straight away take that walkway to our air concourse level. And there's one more interesting aspect to that. We have connected our air concourse level with our commercial building also through the walkway. It is coming up. So it will act not only as a transport hub, but as a business center with an added facility of transportation. So this is how, I mean, it has been planned, and within a 2 years time, all these things will be integrated.
Great, sir. Great to know that. Mr. Avnish, so many amenities, facilities under one roof, world-class infrastructure, surely it is expensive. So how do you intend to transfer this cost to the customer? What kind of pricing models would you be using when charging from the passenger and your customers?
So interesting. This is an interesting question which was in everybody's mind. I don't know. Yesterday itself, the railways have given a declaration in the Times of India. The government has been working, the cabinet has been working on a formula of a user fee. That's there. And it was only there in the papers yesterday where they said that it has been internally approved, it has yet to be gazetted. So what it will be is depending on to the class of the city where the station is getting developed, there will be a fee of 10 rupees to 50 rupees that will automatically get added to the ticket cost for the alighting customer as well as the boarding customer. So if, for example, if you are going to Delhi by a Shatabdi and you are boarding from Habibganj, your ticket will automatically get added by a cost whatever as per the city level of Bhopal goes. So that part will be taking care of the cost of the station as such. But when you come to commercial developments, the commercial buildings that we are building are self-profit generating, self-revenue generating, and we expect to make profits out of those buildings in themselves, like any other shopping center, any other mall, any other hotel, or any other hospital. So they will be self-sufficient, whereas the railway station buildings will be supported A, by the increased revenue that comes out of the sales and the rentals that are coming in from the various retail shopkeepers, as well as from advertisements, from parking. These are some of the main heads which will give revenue to the revenues to the railway station, plus the user fee component. And as I said, the commercial buildings, whichever class they are, will be seeing their profitability coming out from the business that they are generating from their business.
Right, sir. So since this complex is also going to be a retail destination, so how will you convince, or what pull strategy will you use to get the top retailers to set up shop in the complex?
So, well, that's very easy. The most important part for a pull for a retailer is the footfall. The footfall in the right place, the right offering that gets planned for that footfall will automatically result in conversions. So I will not need to pull retailers. Once the development is seen by the retailers, once the footfall is seen by the developers, automatically they will come and start offering. So I would still say the location and the footfall will act as generators in themselves.
Right.
Obviously, we have to adopt to marketing techniques and the marketing practices that are needed to keep the malls alive, to keep the hotels alive. All that will need to be done as per the business that is being conducted in those buildings. But overall, if you see, it's the footfall that a retailer will see and come for itself.
So Asif, sir, while this is a fun place, a happening place for visitors, we must not forget many of them can be differently abled. What facilities or features have been incorporated to aid the differently abled?
We have considered
Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, sir.
I did not unmute actually before speaking. Yes, we have considered that aspect also while designing. I mean, for a differently able person, I mean, the permanent features which we have added in the design is introduction of toilets for a differently able person at every platform, which was not there earlier. I mean, Habibganj station had only one differently abled friendly toilet at close to the waiting room. Now we have created differently abled friendly toilet at all the floors of our terminal building and all the platforms, that too centrally located. That is one aspect. Second one is for wheelchair bound passengers. We have introduced lifts from our terminal building to the air concourse, and from air concourse, those wheelchair bound passengers can take lifts from air concourse to the different platforms. That is second permanent feature. Third feature is we are fixing tactiles and braille map. That shall help those who are challenged visually. And also we have introduced the battery operated cars. battery operated cars that shall take differently able person, even senior citizens and the people who are impaired temporarily to their various locations, to the boats, inbound passengers and outbound passengers. And of course, the mandatory ramps are also there, but we intend to move differently challenged people through VHT, that is vertical and horizontal transport system. And for visually challenged, we propose to place marshals also, apart from this tactiles and braille mapping. Entire station is being braille mapped also to help visually challenged passengers or the users rather in general terms. So that's what we have done.
Great engineering feat, I must say, but still I'm tempted to ask you this question that in designing this station, did you also have a futuristic perspective in mind, meaning that in future, will this infrastructure be able to support maybe bullet trains or state of our travel of the future?
I don't know how many students are clear about the concept of bullet train. Let me clear, when railways or anybody talks of a bullet train, we talk of a travel speed of 350 kilometers or more. That is one prime aspect. So in order to bring in bullet train to Habibganj station, we need to lay entirely a different track. As on date, the maximum track speed allowed on conventional track is 180 kilometers, but the maximum allowable speed as on date is 150 kilometers. So the existing tracks at Habibganj railway station shall not be able to bring in the bullet train. Yes. Building wise, we have considered all the vibrations and sonic booms that the bullet train shall create, and we had incorporated those parameters in our design. By incorporating those parameters of sonic booms and vibrations of the travel of bullet train, we have increased the mandatory cost. But yes, it is future ready to take in the bullet train, provided the tracks are replaced or new tracks are laid. Yes, one important thing which we have incorporated in this station in present context with the existing track is there is a provision of double stack freight movement. Many of you might have witnessed that now certain freight trains or goods train in general term carries containers stacked one over other. They are known as double stack container. So there is a height constraint. So while making a new air concourse over the tracks, we have created a clear height. So as a double stack container can pass through. That is the immediate provision which we have made and which is now being incorporated by all the new construction or height structures in the railways. So yes, we have incorporated all the futuristic possibilities which we can foresee as on date. Yes.
Great to know that, sir. My next question will be to Mr. Avnish. So, Avnish, sir, I must say you have achieved a great feat in making this complex operational, soon to be inaugurated by the Prime Minister. That is what we are hearing in the media. But do you also see a challenge in changing the mental landscape of people, changing the perception in the minds of common people towards the railway station, perhaps changing the culture, the appropriate civic behavior? In short, a mindset change at the perceptual and behavioral level.
Well, Dr. Archana, I remember having a chat with you on the phone when you invited me. And this was exactly that you asked.
Absolutely. I picked it up from there and I thought I must share it so that everybody gets to know that.
I will answer it the same way, that it's actually a chicken and an egg situation that is there. You know, whether you provide first or you wait for the person to change to it first. Over here, we have created it. We are anticipating certain operational issues in this, especially from the unreserved class of passengers that travel. reserved second class and the AC class are capable enough of taking care of themselves. They understand they are exposed enough to these aspects. But yes, we will have to take care of the unreserved class of people that do travel. They'll have to be learning. We'll be having people, there'll be marshals like Abuji just told you. And we'll try our best to make them get friendly with this, with these offerings that we are giving. Also to say, the railways have a concept of a Janta Meal. The catering policy has tea offerings, coffee offerings for as low as 7 rupees, which may get increased to 8 rupees. They have a thali that they serve for 18 to 20 rupees. And you'll be surprised that our concessionaires that we are getting in are very happy to serve thali for 250 rupees as well as a thali of 18 to 20 rupees as per the specifications of the railways, and even make it better as an offering to the other passengers. So I'm sure with time things will change, and I'm glad that we are being the ones who are first to provide it for them, and we are not really scared of this challenge. We'll take it up, though operationally it'll be our issue to manage the maintenance of toilets, of other facilities that are there, and I think we'll see it through.
I'm sure you will, sir. So many challenges surmounted, this will also get done. And so we have Brigadier Bambani, sir, with us. Sir, would you want to say something or ask a question, maybe? Sir is also a person who was instrumental in designing our college and taking care of all of that. Over to you, Bambani, sir.
Thank you, ma'am. With your permission, I have a question for both the speakers. The general question, two questions actually. Partially you have answered it. When do you expect to break even in this whole activity as far as your funding is concerned? My second question is, what is the life of this structure? Because we are projecting all these things, and now that we know that it is all construction in RCC, reinforced cement concrete, which doesn't have unlimited life, therefore how long? Two linked question. Break even, what is the life of the structure? Thank you.
Abuji, please go first with the life of structure.
Good afternoon, sir. I mean, this was the question I was expecting actually. About the RCC structure, life of structure, I'll answer, and break even, Mr. Avnish shall take up. In our concession agreement, which we call development agreement, there is a provision of designing the structure to withstand 120 years of life. The service life stipulated is 120 years. When I went through that concession agreement, I was surprised because there is no CODEL provision in BIS, which we call Bureau of Indian Standard, to make any structure withstand 120 years of lifespan. So I would like to share with all the students, it will take only 2 minutes, 1.5 minutes rather, that this is for the first time that any station redevelopment has been taken in integrated model, and as per agreement stipulation, we have to hire a detailed design engineering consultant, that is what we call DDE. So immediately after signing the agreement, I went into search mode, and I was surprised to observe that there are no such independent consultant in India. At that time, there was no, 2017, and those consultants who were competent enough were not ready to get into this kind of activity. Ultimately, we wrote an AECOM. So AECOM is our detailed design engineering consultant. And those who were leading the structural design team from AECOM and myself had a long discussion. So how to incorporate this 120 years of life. So we have, shortlisted few items to increase the life. Any structural deterioration takes place due to corrosion mostly and cyclic loading. These are the two aspects. So for design purpose, we have increased the cyclic loading part. Much, much beyond the stipulated by Bureau of Stainless Standards. We have increased the cover of concrete. Those who understand civil engineering, they will appreciate this. And we have provided extra coating over the steel reinforcement in form of a special reinforced coating. Special resin coating, which is patented by only one agency in India. So we have roped in few parameters so as to incorporate that stipulation of 120 years of design life. And we are confident, our team is confident that it will easily cross 100 years of lifetime. I am not very sure about last 15 years, but 150 years, 100 years is yes. It will withstand the earthquake, all corrosions. Except for any external impacts, heavy damages, it will withstand for at least 100 years. Over to Mr. Avnish on return of investment part.
Thank you, Mr. Bambani. So, coming to the part of break even, you have to basically understand how we are treating the financial aspect of this project. So if you see, there is one mandatory cost that has come up to us where we have to provide the station to the government. The bid cost for that was 100 crores. By the time we have finished, I think Abuji will be able to tell you, I think it's easily doubled. It's 200 crores. So 100 crore planning has gone up to 200 crores. So what happens is that the land that we get in place of this railway station building gets amortized between the various classes of real estate that we are building around it. And each class of real estate, the business it produces will be responsible for the break even of that one particular project in itself. So coming to Habibganj, our first project is a commercial building. That commercial building is being partly sold or rather subleased, and partly we are leasing it directly to tenants. This should get this building through in the next 2-2.5 years of its operation. It should be out of the red. When you go to a hotel, a 5-star hotel today easily takes 6-7 years of operation to be out of the red. Then you go to the hospital part. So when we are coming to the hospital part, the most interesting part why we designed a hospital is because our company owns and operates the biggest hospital of Bhopal today. And health is one factor where our vision is there for expansion. And this will be our first step towards an expansion of the hospital. Generally speaking, out of our own experience, we see that it takes 4-5 years for us to break even in a hospital operation. Similarly, a shopping mall is there. A shopping mall also has a 5-year to 6-year period of breaking even. So each of the projects will be taken as a whole separately. We will not take it as a whole. The moment I amortize the land into each of these costs, which has been given to me in lieu of that 200 crores that I have spent for the railways, they automatically get out of the red. So I hope I've been able to make you understand the economics of this project. Essentially, so in our case, the location has been very good. Abuji has something else to add in this, so I'll just request him to take it up. Bhamani sir.
Okay, thank you very much. I'll just, after Abu has finished, then I'll want to chip in a little bit more.
Absolutely, please.
You said something about return on investment. Actually, the entire being first of its kind, I was asked to do the financial modeling, or rather the drawdown schedule for this entire project. I mean, 447 crores, which I did, and our this financial advisors took it to the lenders. Initially, return on investment period was envisaged as 7 years, but due to Corona and different various reasons, it may extend up to another 2 or 3 years. So maximum 10 years from commissioning would be the gestation period for this. So I think that is what I mean in is the objective answer to your very pointed question, I guess.
I rest think so. Very comprehensively answered by Asif sir and
let me just say one more word. I would say excellent modeling. Fine. But in India, as we know, there are more imponderables than ponderables. Yes. So it is imponderable, which is going to be a challenge, both in construction and in costing and in getting the revenue out of it. Particularly with the city like Bhopal. Bhopal is an upcoming city. I have lived in that city during my younger days. It used to be the city of Nawabs and big Darwazas and all those things. They're all gone. And I still have some property in an area called Civil Lines. Of course, your location, Habibganj, is ideal because it is close to New Bhopal. And the old Bhopalis would hardly come to that place because they are happy with their main railway station and the airport, which is at somewhere called Baragarh. But nonetheless, I'm happy that a mid-sized city like Bhopal is getting all the attention. And with both you gentlemen and your organization, it's got a bright future as a city. And to you, Abu Sahib, and to Avinish. God bless both of you.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you.
Thank you.
Definitely a very, very unique, exciting, futuristic project, amalgamation of a railway station with any and everything you can associate with luxury and leisure. Indeed, a first of its kind conceptualization and execution. Mr. Avnish and Mr. Asif, wish you all the very best for the success of this project. And we are immensely grateful to you for taking the time out in spite of your very pressing engagements. I know you all were traveling a lot, but even amidst all of this, you did take time for us. So thank you so much for being here with us today.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Archana. Thanks for having us with you on this.
Sir, I'll hand it back to the compares and request you to stay back a couple of minutes more.
Thank you, ma'am. May I now request student manager Munish Sharma to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Kashish. I, Munish Sharma, on behalf of our SBUP, all the directors, faculty members, and my fellow students, managers of Sri Balaji University, extend a deep gratitude to Mr. Avnish Hasija sir for giving us such excellent advice and for sharing with us your experience. I thank you for giving us your valuable time and honoring us with your presence. And definitely, we will inculcate these takeaways in our life for a better future ahead. Sir, we thank you for being with us and it's been a privilege listening to you. We also wish to thank our founder chancellor, Dr. Colonel A. Balasubramaniam sir, Honorable Vice Chancellor sir, and all directors, faculty members, student managers, and their parents. We have gained a lot from you, sir, and we look forward for many more interaction with you off as well as on the campus. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Monish.
So just a minute more, sir.
Thank you, Monish. May I now request student manager Prachi Tejwani to deliver the vote of thanks.
Thank you, Kashish. On behalf of Sri Balaji University, Pune, I, Prachi Tejwani, would like to extend the word of thanks to our honorable guest speaker, Abu Asif sir, for spending his precious time with us. Sir taught us that it is important to set a goal and believe it can be achieved despite the challenges. A manager's job is to come up with a solution when seeing a problem, like Sir did with Air Concourse and Subway to solve the issue of intermixing of passengers. Sir, we will definitely inculcate these takeaways in our life. We have learned a lot from you, sir. We look forward to many more interactions off as well as on the campus. Thank you.
Thank you. Best wishes.
Thank you, Prachi. I now request Professor Bhushan Pednekar, Department of PM and HRD, to present the token of gratitude to our guest, Anvish Hasija, sir.
Nice to hear from you. And I can say personally, it's very hard to believe that a railway station can be converted, look like airports. It's very hard to believe. And I must congratulate both of you for your the wonderful achievement is there. And I can say it's only the three words is I can see the you can see the output of that. You can see the you can see the belief, your imagination and the achievement. This thing can be, you can say, rightly applicable to your achievement is there. And I personally feel that I love to visit the Habibganj railway station to see all this kind of infrastructure which have been developed over a period of time. So congratulations to both of you, sir. And it's worth watching your or sharing whatever the information you share. It's really valuable for us. For just token of gratitude, like the Avani sir is there looking as a CEO. So sir has gone through a lot of opportunities are there during the entire process of developing the Habibganj railway station. So we offer him a small token of gratitude from the group on our side because sir is all the time on the hot seat. So I can see the hot seat from the JFE Malt. We would love to offer him that book has been there. So I hope, sir, you can go through it through that. Yeah. Thank you, sir. And with respect to Abu, sir, again, I think as a team leader, your achievement is also commendable. And I can see a lot of challenges you must have been facing because what we look like, it's just outward, but inside you took a lot of efforts for that. So looking to all the engineering efforts from that, we'll give you a token of gratitude for engineering the future of civilization from the John Brown years then. Hope this will be helpful for you in this regard. Yeah. Thank you. Thank you very much, both of you. Thank you. Thank you very much. Yeah. Over to you, Kampan.
Thank you. Thank you very much. It was really a very great session. Thank you. Namaste, sir.
Welcome you sometime with Ashish.
Sure, sir. And do come to our campus physically, sir, to interact with our students.
Next time I'm in Pune, I will certainly.
Definitely. Thank you.
Kashish, go on, please.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. With this, we come to the end of first half of BIM Marketing Symposium 2021. We will now have a break for quick cooking lunch and will request you all to join back at 1:50 p.m. Thank you.
Using the second link, not the first link, so all of you can please note, using the second link, please be back by 1:50. Thank you.
Thank you, sirs.